Good afternoon, everybody. It's nice to see a full hall. It's great. Nice to see all this interest in what design can do for urban issues. And I think it's obvious that design can do all kinds of things for urban issues, yes? It can make some things terrible, and it can make some things really interesting and good and cool and find solutions. VBAT has organized this breakout session and a project called the Meat Market. That is with two E's, about meeting. Of course, a lot of you are young designers, so I think you're faced with the possibility of the meat market with the other, with the A in it, in the sense of, like, you know, this big question about how to move forward with your career and your intentions. I think what's behind the idea of the meat market very much is that VBAT understands and wants to reach out and invite encounters, meetings with new ideas, new people, new talent. The label, the name given to this is the wise and the curious. I think it's the wise and the curious, and the curious and the wise, or the wise and the curious, in the sense of there's a lot of experience going to be here in a moment, and there's a lot of curiosity out there, but there's also a lot of wisdom out there and a lot of curiosity over here. So I think it's a two-way street, and that's really important and beautiful. I think that there's a reality which I think everybody's aware of, that this is the first time in history where more people are in cities than not. You know, more than half of the world population is in cities now, and that's just going to keep on developing. So obviously that brings with it certain questions, certain issues: overpopulation, overcrowding, pollution, waste management, a general sense of anxiety. So the question is, what can design do? And there's all kinds of design, of course. There's graphic design, which I guess you would put in the area of communication and storytelling. And I think storytelling is a very important issue in terms of creating community and creating understanding and connections between people. And then there's other kinds of design. There's architectural design. There's product design. All these things have a huge impact on the quality of life. So what we're interested in is stimulating a discussion and getting ideas going, and also a view into the future in terms of that the problems which are coming up are also opportunities, and especially for people interested in design and people interested in other fields as well, because those problems need to be addressed. And so it's good to start getting into that kind of mindset about thinking about what can I do to provoke some reflection, to come up with an interesting solution to some problem, and to start really locally, to start really where you are, how you look at things. This is, I'm an artist myself, and I think there's obviously a big connection between art and design. I would say design is an art. They're both expressions of the human creativity. And I think that the function of both of these is to awaken the things that are asleep. Yeah, so all around us there are things that are asleep, and you'll see many examples of that as we go on that have been woken up by just looking at them in a certain way. Okay. Those of you who have signed up for this, in terms of there's a possibility of having a portfolio review by some of the creatives of VBAT, and there's also a pizza box, which you can take it home afterwards. It's got all kinds of important things, like a notebook where you can write down your ideas. It's important to be collecting ideas all the time. Every time you run into you see something, you say, oh yeah, that maybe I could do that with that, you know? And that way you're collecting things that can turn into brilliant things that can help us all move forward. And when the pizza box is empty, you can also put a pizza in it later if you're working late. And so that will be for you afterwards. And now I'd like to introduce Graham Sturt, who is the man who initiated and conceived the meat market idea, this meeting place between the professionals of VBAT and young designers and young talent. There is an invitation here.
So what we want to do is we want to inspire you today to engage with urban issues and maybe even come up with some solutions of your own. And you know, you don't have to come up with a solution today, but if you kind of look at some of the inspiration we have in our presentation and it triggers you and you actually want to do something with it, come back to us with your idea, and we'd love to kind of maybe talk to you about how we can bring this idea to life. So that's a takeout from the end of the presentation, and it's an open invitation to you all. So yeah, please, you know, enjoy the presentation, get inspired, and you know, talk to us.
I think one thing that I'd like to say about VBAT is that their motto is this word, refreshing. And I think that they are constantly refreshing themselves. So this invitation is really about bringing in fresh ideas and refreshing the situation and the possibilities.
Thank you.
Okay. And we have a very special guest today. And his name is Stefan Sagmeister, and he's from New York, and he's a very well-known designer who I think has had quite an impact on many different things, and he's here to share his experiences and his...
Good afternoon.
Well, good afternoon. Hello.
So, we're going to run through this presentation. We've been asking a question 2 weeks ago, which was through Twitter, and it was essentially for all of you to provide questions for this session. We did it via Twitter, and I'm trying to juggle three technologies here, so hopefully bear with me, and I'm trying to press this thing, look at the Twitter feed here, and talk to Stefan and you, so please bear with me, I'll get the hang of it in a minute. First of all, I'd like to play a small film about you to introduce anybody who's not familiar with Stefan Sagmeister to Stefan.
Okay. Hi, my name is Stefan Sagmeister. I am an Austrian graphic designer who lives and works in New York City. I used to be in a very terrible band when I was 13 and 14, and we were awful. But through that band, I got interested in album covers. It was the real first time when I thought, well, this would be an interesting thing to occupy myself with during my life. Part of this quest to bring my own personality into the work manifested itself in designing sentences that came out of my diary. Some of these maxims I've really internalized, like, having guts always works out for me, but that doesn't mean that I'm fearless all the time.
So I hope that brings everyone up to date with yourself. Does it kind of give a good reflection?
Well, I think that it made one thing clear, you know, I think in the very beginning is that I'm an Austrian graphic designer. And so everything that I have to say on urban issues, please take it with a grain of salt, because, you know, I'm not an architect or not an urban planner. So I'm looking at that issue basically from the same point of view as many of you in the audience do, you know, as somebody who lives in an urban space. And here and there, we've done a project that that deals with that, and I think we talked about
it
yesterday.
Yeah. Later.
But yeah. In general, of course, my my world comes from graphics.
So as I said earlier, we've got the Twitter feed running currently. So if you don't want to put your hand up during the public audience questions, please tweet your question. So you can tweet your question via hashtag AskSagmeister. So we'll move to our first question. So we had a kind of point earlier about this.
You might want to just take that up a little bit.
Okay, so it's scratching.
It's when it starts scratching, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. Scratching on the beard. Yeah.
That will do it.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
First design issue solved.
Yeah. Is it an urban issue?
Clearly, it's, yeah. Since it's happening in Amsterdam.
It's solved. Great. It's back again. Can someone help me with this, please? Okay, we'll try this. It's still working. Yeah.
Let's get the specialists in.
I really should have trimmed my beard.
All right. I think that's it.
I think we're done.
Yeah.
So, I want to talk a little bit here about some of the mega cities which mm-hmm. have risen in the recent decades. So, Jakarta, Mumbai. Mexico City, for instance. Have you visited any of these places?
I've been to all three, yes.
And what's your experience there? Do you experience urban issues there, or any stories you can tell us about that?
Tons. I mean, all three have massive problems of inequality. I was, you know, living in the U.S., I always thought that the U.S. was the most unequal country in the world. That got redirected very quickly by those three cities. I've been actually, recently I drove by a house in Mumbai. We have an Indian client, so we visited Mumbai in February. I drove by a house in Mumbai that a guy built that's a 30 or 28-story skyscraper that he built for himself, his wife, and his two children. It has an 8-story parking garage with hundreds of cars in there. And I think the wife thinks it's haunted by a ghost, so they never moved in.
It's the most expensive house on earth, I think.
Yeah. And that house is literally a, you know, 5-minute car ride away from one of the largest slums in the world that we actually also extensively visited because we were there for a client who is manufacturing the biggest mango juice in India, and they are actually selling it also in the slums, and there is a very functioning grocery store system, if you can call it that, like a little hut, so who sell that? But it's so I know these cities, but I know them maybe a little bit better than a tourist, but not from a real professional level. So I couldn't, like, oh my God, I would be extremely far away of making proper suggestions on how, let's say, to solve an inequality problem in Mumbai. What I do understand, I mean, I understand from what I learned very quickly in Mumbai was that part of the housing problem is a gigantic housing problem, meaning that if you move to Mumbai now and you want an apartment, the apartments are actually more expensive than in Manhattan.
Wow.
And that is apparently very much and very counterintuitively driven by an incredibly rigid rent freeze scheme. Like, there's a rent control that is so rigid in Mumbai where a lot of people live in houses that they paid $1 or 50 cents rent a month for 30 years, that the landlords of these houses cannot, with that little rent income, cannot fix them up.
Yeah.
And the renters would never move out because they could never even think of getting anything, any equivalent. And therefore you have vast parts of Mumbai literally deteriorating to the point where I did read one Nobel Prize winning economist's view on that, who wrote that the easiest way to really ruin a city is an incredibly stiff rent control.
Like, like his opinion was that you can actually ruin a city much more effectively than if you bomb it with an incredible rigid rent control. And I think that in Mumbai, that would definitely be proof of that theory. But again, you know, I read a couple of articles on it. It's not that's I couldn't really tell you deep knowledge on that. Okay. Probably, I'm sure that many of you were over there just for the session before. Cameron Sinclair, I'm sure, could.
Okay. Well, interestingly, we'll come to a solution for rent control later, so we'll talk about that. I'm going to move to a public question now. So whenever you see any of the wise and curious characters come up, then this is an open invitation to any of you in the audience to kind of raise your hand and ask a question. So. At this point, have we got any questions? We do.
I got the microphone.
Okay, would you like to stand up, please?
Yes.
And what's your name, please?
Johanna from Berlin, Germany.
Okay.
My question is, what is or was the most important thing for you when you started your business, or maybe still is?
Most important issue for me when I started the business? Probably from a direction-wise, the feeling in the belly that it's the right thing to do, and the feeling that I had about it was that I wanted to do a small studio that remained small, that would combine my two loves, design and music. And as soon as I had that thought, it just felt right. Like it felt like, wow, that's actually, I really want that. Like I really, that's like the right thing to do, and I could I thought I could pull it off. Not that I had any music clients, I had none, but I kind of thought I can go after that, and it seemed juicy. And then possibly from a little bit later on point of view. So those the issues were music and staying small, and then from a little bit later on, I think an important issue. Was that I actually properly thought about money. And that I had an advantage because I come from my parents had a store, so my two older brothers took that store over and became kind of businessmen. And so I had advice from within the family, and my older brother told me, like, if you don't watch the money, you're going to be out of business in a year or two, and it's going to be miserable. Because going out of business takes you a while, and it's really awful. And so, from the very beginning, I took money seriously, as in, I created a little system, a tiny little system that made sure that I knew how much money we're going to spend, and made sure that I knew how much money is going to come in. And it's the money never was foremost of our mind. But because we took it seriously, it didn't have to. And we, until now, we never got rich, but we're doing fine.
Okay. Thank you for your question. Thank you. Let's move on now and talk about your living in New York. Mm-hmm. You've lived there for a good part of your life.
Yeah.
And I'd love to hear about your own experience of being a New York citizen. And the changes you've seen over the past few decades in terms of urban issues?
Well, I think that, of course, I could talk about forever and ever and ever. I first came to New York in 1981, just after high school, and then I moved there in 86 because I loved it so much in 81. And it was a very, very different place to where it is now. I used to live on Clinton Street in the Lower East Side. We had a gigantic heroin market on our block where the various brand names of heroin were shouted out loud all night long. So the entire night was like, Roadrunner, 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 Brand New Works, Brand New Works. The cops didn't do anything. Or when you looked out the window and you saw these mostly 60, 70 drug dealers suddenly all dispersing, you know in 5 minutes the cops are going to come. So they all were pre-informed about any raid that was happening. And that got transformed into a totally different space. Like right now, I would say that in 86, when you heard something happened to a friend, you knew that friend got mugged or assaulted or raped. right now, if I hear something happened to a friend, I know that friend was in a bicycle accident.
Okay.
Is clearly the most dangerous thing that can happen to you right now. And it's strange because I actually think that the bodily harm that my friends now have from bicycle accidents is more significant and more serious than the bodily harm that happened to them in the late 70s and early 80s from muggings and assaults.
Do you have tram tracks there? They're quite a big casualty causer here.
Not so much, but I think that in New York, of course, unlike here, the bicycle culture is only about 5 to 10 years old.
Yeah.
So there needs to be some adjusting. You know, like cars are not really used to have that many bikes around. There are bike lanes in place, but not as massively and as continuously as here and so on and so forth.
Sure.
But I think that a good urban issue was at one time formulated by our previous mayor, by Michael Bloomberg, he was the only mayor who went through three periods. So when he first became mayor, and this was right after 9/11, I was in a taxi and he was on the radio, and the interviewer asked him being a billionaire businessman, what he's going to do to make sure that businesses are going to remain in New York after 9/11. And he said, nothing. I'm not giving a shit. I won't do anything to keep any business here, which caused some surprise of the interviewer. And Bloomberg said the only issue that he has as a mayor is to make New York City the most livable city he can. And if he can do that, then the companies won't be able to afford not to be there, because their employees will force them to remain in New York City. And that's exactly what happened. Exactly. No Democrat, he was a pro forma Republican, no Democrat who would have ever dared to say such a thing. But that's literally what happened. Let's say that stupid Swiss bank, UBS, they actually did move out of the city and moved to White Plains, New York. And they had to come back with their tail between the legs because nobody wanted to work for them. Like all the really good talent, nobody wanted to move to White Plains. So they basically, after relocating their, whatever it is, thousands of people up there, they actually came back to Manhattan because it just didn't work. And I think that thinking is really true for any city. If it's a place where you would want to be, then everything else basically falls into place.
Okay. Well, let's move on now and talk about where we are now. How are you finding Amsterdam?
From the outside, I mean, you know, I've never lived here, but I've come here extensively as a visitor, and I am very aware of the differences between the visitorship and the staying somewhere. I loved Berlin as a visitor, and when I moved there, I hated it. But as a visitor, I think it's an incredibly successful place. I would say that in my mind, from the visitor's point of view, Amsterdam would be among my top five favorite cities in the world.
Okay. And how do you think it compares to New York? We've made this little comparison here. Historically, it has a lot of similarities, but I think on scale-wise, Amsterdam's very, very small in comparison. But can you see any similarities between the two?
Well, obviously, they both have red and black logos on white backgrounds. one clearly being influenced by the other.
Exactly, yeah.
I like both design companies, Castle Kramer and Milton Glaser, so I'm fond of both, and I actually do think that I walked by the Rijksmuseum yesterday, and I saw tourists taking photos of the giant type that's in front of it, and that's definitely also an achievement for a fairly new brand that you're developing. Outside of that, I think that they have a couple of things in common. I think that Amsterdam, much more than other places in Europe, has always been a welcoming place for foreigners. And that's very much the case in, so let's say, much more so than, let's say, Paris or London. Mm-hmm. And I feel very similar to New York. You know, I've been there now 25 years, and I've not had a single case where I felt that I didn't get a job, or I didn't get a meeting, or I wasn't invited to something on account of the fact that I have an accent. And I have an accent. Okay. Outside of that, I mean, obviously there's a big difference in scale, there's a big difference in density, but probably the second biggest thing that Amsterdam and New York has is that they're ultimately, I mean, probably Amsterdam is the ultimately is a bikeable city, but it's also a very walkable city.
Yep.
And by walkable, I mean that if you take a walk, it's actually interesting. Like the things that you see, that you encounter, are exciting or delightful or make you do another walk. Berlin is not that. Like, Berlin is boring because so many places that you walk by are just apartment houses where nothing is happening. Mm. But I don't know, did a 20-minute walk to a record store yesterday. I'm going to do it right after this because I forgot my wallet there. and that it was extremely delightful. And I know, I mean, you know, I'm sure that many of you who actually live here will see this quite differently. And we'll see, you know, I'm not really bothered by the drunken hordes of Brits who invade you every July and August.
Every weekend, actually.
Every weekend?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, let's move on now, and we'll actually talk about some of the urban issues here. You touched on one there, which is, I think, everyone's familiar with if you walk around the red light district, but maybe not quite familiar with some of these other ones. So. For instance, overcrowding is a problem in Amsterdam, and anyone who has a first or second floor apartment will know about overcrowding and the fact that the stairs are nearly vertical in all apartments. Mm-hmm. It's because the population is so densely packed here. Noise is, of course, a problem. Even tram tracks cause a lot of noise in neighborhoods.
I hear roller bags are a really big problem, no?
Roller blades.
No roller bags, like the people.
Because most of the streets are kind of cobbles as well, so they kind of chatter around on the top.
So that's a design problem, no?
Yeah, we have to solve this one today, maybe. Yeah. Drunken tourism, you touched on this one, and sometimes wish I wasn't British walking around the red light district, but it's, it's a problem in the city. Trash can be a problem as well in the small streets, when the bags don't get collected. The loss of green spaces. I think someone told me earlier that on the Weiselstraat, there used to be a really lovely avenue of trees, and that's been cleared now. And the clearing of trees even, means loss of green spaces. Air pollution is a real problem here in Europe. I think the Netherlands rates very highly in terms of air pollution, but you wouldn't really think it necessarily. You commented yesterday that that was a surprising fact. Transportation can be a problem here as well. And even loneliness can be an issue as well. Being in a city on your own can be no fun sometimes. So this is a reminder of the beer bikes, which run around the city. Singing happy songs. So a question here, what do you think will be the biggest issues facing city dwellers in the future? We touched upon some just then.
I think it's non-spaces. I think for such a long time, for the last 100 years, there's this whole idea of concentrating on functionalism. So many of the spaces that have been built in the last 80 years are really built with only one thing in mind, this function, and they under complete negation of other things like beauty or joy. And I think we heard a fantastic talk yesterday by Michael, who talked about the dignity that this female stonemason would get out of building the hospital, that the work would dignify her, but as a builder, but then of course also would be a completely different feeling for the people who would be in there. And I think we see a complete shift on that in the avant-garde of buildings. Let's say, I'll give you an example, the two friends of mine, Liz Diller and Rick Scofidio, were responsible, or were the architect of the High Line in New York, which some of you might have heard of. It became a quite famous urban development. It's a refurbishment of an old train track that is hilariously successful on all fronts, both money-wise. It generated billions and billions of dollars in investments around it because people wanted to live close by. But the most surprising fact of the High Line I found is that it's now been 5.5 years in operation, and millions and millions, I mean, of people visited it, and the police precincts that surround the High Line have not had a single report of a criminal act since the existence of the High Line. I mean, isn't that amazing? And that must have something to do with the love and the care that it has been designed. And I think the forces at hand or at work are exactly the same as the one that are at work at the hospital that Michael was talking about mm-hmm. yesterday, or that the things that Cameron is talking about. And I think that for the longest time, because of an Austrian, a German, and a Swiss guy, and I'm talking Adolf Loos, Mies van der Rohe, and Corbusier, this idea that it's all about functionalism, that's what we are about, sort of like infested our brains in all architecture schools around the world. And I think some of these ideas were very fallible and very excusable in 1920. By now they are just revealed as utter stupidity. And, you know, I mean, if you say something against Mies now, you're still left out of any room that is from architects because they still think he's God. Well, if you go to the Bauhaus archive, there is a letter from Mies to Hitler offering his services. So morally, Corbusier worked for the Vichy government. Loos was just his grave was just taken away by the Viennese government because he fucked 12-year-olds. So morally, these guys are very questionable. But I would say that many of them had really good ideas for that time. But we've had them for 100 years. Mm-hmm. And that sort of functionalism, specifically the second and third generation that was influenced by them, who transformed their whole idea, because of course Adolf Loos was very much about beauty also, but transformed those ideas into a economic functionalism that then in the 50s built these giant swaps of social housing, get as many people as efficiently housed, and many of them 10 or 15 years later needed to be dynamited because one thing they didn't do was they didn't function. And that whole and I think that this sort of thinking is the one that will probably will have to be completely rethought. And there is so many spaces, and it's not just in the United States, but I know the States the best, and there's many of them, that is just vast spaces that are non-spaces. They are not considered. You look around, you can look up and down, and nothing that you see has been considered with human well-being in mind. And these are spaces where it's not worthwhile to live in. They create social problems. I mean, I think that's, as we've seen in Baltimore, they are not fit for human living. And I think that one of the reasons that you have, and it's connected, one of the reasons that you have mass tourism, that you have these people who live in shitty spaces, all want to come to Amsterdam and to Venice and to Florence, is, I think, this is my own theory, so it's unproven, but I think it's because of the desire for beauty. If their own spaces actually would be gorgeous, they might have less of a desire to flock to these little points of beauty. And of course, the problem with that is that, as we've seen, they diminish because it's so massive, they diminish the beauty of those spaces. If you go in August to Venice, I mean, you still see the beauty, but it's definitely lessened seriously by all the day glow T-shirts that's standing in front of the altar in San Marco.
Yeah. Okay. We're going to move now to a question from a lady called Babette Porcelain. Babette, are you here? Okay. Babette has an initiative called Think Big, Act Now, which is crowdfunding currently, and she'd like to ask you a question.
Thank you. Hi. My question is actually, how do you think design can help to communicate about sustainability to the people of Amsterdam? Because what we find difficult is that the reward of sustainability is a very long time ahead of us.
Mm-hmm.
It's not instant rewarding. The other problem is that it's quite a heavy subject and people tend to turn away from it. So how would you as a designer recommend us, or how would you tackle this problem? How would you make people feel the urgence of having a sustainable lifestyle?
It's complex and difficult. My guess would be I would try a two-pronged approach, both a reward and a punishment. Or I know that very recently there has been a very good study on what makes people stop smoking. And they've had 500 people in a group that was rewarded, and 500 people in a group that was punished, and then they had 500 people in a group with some sort of mixture, and the mixture seems to have worked best. Now, what the reward and what the punishment would be, it would have to be, of course, designed locally and very specifically, and very much on what level of information the society is. My guess would be that it's a fairly, from an international comparison point of view, my guess would be that the people in Amsterdam know already a lot about sustainability know already a lot about the importance of it. My guess would, I mean, I know Germany much better, even though I'm Austrian, but I know that the information levels in Germany, for example, would be much, much higher than the United States. And coming to think of it, or I know that, let's say, in Austria, it's actually also a mixture. So, for example, you can get you are rewarded. My niece has just exchanged all the windows of the house against quadruple glass, super energy efficient, extreme windows. And 80% of those windows were paid for by the Austrian government because they were on that and that street. And there's a program that says if you go super energy efficient, you only pay 20% of that window. But you own the window, of course, so it's you're upping the value of your house significantly, but you only pay 20%. Then, of course, there is punishment if you don't, I don't know, put your glass in the correct container and all that stuff. So that would be my guess, the two-pronged approach, because my guess would be that stopping smoking and stopping wasting energy are sort of in the similar mindset. I mean, one has an addiction to it, so it's a little bit different, but they are sort of in a similar mindset. But there is if you Google the cigarette story, it's very recent. If you just Google New York Times study cigarette stopping smoking, it's in there, and it seemed very authoritative. You know, because we've been doing this movie on happiness, I found that I can find a study to prove pretty much anything that I want. So any theory that I can come up with, if I look long and hard enough, I'll find a study that supports that theory. And I also found that among proper scientists, there is a big differentiation made among studies that they believe in and studies that they don't. And some of it has to do with brand names, like brand name scientists, brand name universities. And it's a little bit of a tricky way, but this one seemed to be proper.
Okay. Thank you for your question. Thank you. We'll move now to some questions from the audience. Anybody with a question?
Hi.
Hi.
You just talked about the functionalism and how it's time for it to die.
Yeah.
Do you have any other ism that might take over?
Beauty.
Beautyism. Yeah.
And I have to qualify that. I, of course, don't think that functionalism really should be replaced, but I think I really think it should be augmented. I think that most of the things that we do, that we go after in life as a with a design strategy, seem to be complex. And I found it through my own experience to be a mistake to use only one strategy to go after a complex issue. And I've learned that from my own thing with happiness, and I'll talk about the whole thing a little bit later on in the room over there, where I found that when I thought I could train my mind in the same way as I can train my body and really basically pursue happiness directly, it worked punctuality in a particular strategy, but ultimately I think that pursuit, and it's really like basically to increase my well-being in life, is a set of very complex issues that's not pursuable with a single strategy. And it's even, and I think that it would be the same fallacy to now say, let's replace functionalism with beauty. I was joking, I don't mean that. Because, let's say, and the nice thing is that with beauty, we have historical records what happened. Let's say the 19th century was obsessed with beauty. That so much of the art of the 19th century is all about beauty. And I recently, not long ago, like literally 3 or 4 months ago, went to the Neue Pinakothek in Munich, which is a museum dedicated to the 19th century. And I was sort of surprised by how much I did not like the work in it, considering how interested I am in beauty, specifically in human-made beauty. And my explanation for it is that the artists of the 19th century went so directly after beauty that what they wound up with is kitsch. They didn't really reach beauty in the same way that the guys and the architects in the 50s who only went after function wound up with stuff that did not work. And there is, and in the same way maybe that when I went after happiness, I became deeply unhappy. I think it's these issues are complex. Even when they're much simpler, they're complex. And I was surprised to hear here when I came here that apparently Airbnb is a big problem in Amsterdam, where everybody rents out their apartments now, goes to Utrecht for the weekend, and you have places populated by tourists that never were populated by tourists because they were populated by people who live here. Like, now the founder of Airbnb was a classmate of Jessica, my partner. And I can guarantee you that he would have never envisioned that his idea, his college dorm idea to populate, to make a space for people who go to a concert, would wind up being a urban problem of mass tourism in Amsterdam. You know, it's just amazing. Yeah. And, you know, in a similar way that the Wright brothers couldn't quite foresee airline membership clubs. It's just... these things develop, and these are pretty specified systems. So the bigger issues, of course, are completely unforeseeable.
Okay. Brings me to a really nice quote we found from you. In short, it feels like it's made by humans for humans, and it kind of triggered us to start thinking about looking at some solutions to inspire people. And the first thing that we found was something that you've spoken about before, which is the Bubble Project by Jai Lee. And what we loved about this was it kind of gave a space for people to just kind of fill in and you know, take over billboards and actually have a voice. And we really loved that. That's a kind of a way to give people a voice, but also to actually kind of raise a smile as well, make people happier within the city.
And basically, he printed 500,000 speech bubbles in two sizes, and him and his friends put them all over ads that were all over New York City and in other cities. And very amazingly, were filled in by passersby in many very, I would have thought before he did it that most people just write, you know, whatever, fuck Bush or some, you know, equally inconsequential things. But the writing, some of the writing was absolutely fantastic. And I do think it's one of those projects where ultimately everybody wins. Like, G gets to do his project. The public gets ads that are somewhat more interesting. Mm. The advertisers get people to actually look at their ads because they've been interacted with from the public. It's it was a very successful project. He's a very smart man.
Yeah. So then we went to look to see if we could find a kind of more up-to-date version, something that did something similar to kind of cheer people up in a kind of a confined space of an underground train. On the London Underground, there's a thing called stickers on the Central Line. Various signage of the London Underground has been taken over by someone with quite a good sense of humour, and they're kind of hidden. You know, and people they just sit there from the northern, you know, from one part of London to another, and they discover them. And I think that cheers people up on the Underground. And you know, it's kind of fun, but it's also, there's a message there. I think the person who designed it was fed up with being told what to do, so they wanted to do something with this. So this is a solution to an urban issue as well.
But there's a president in New York from about 15 years ago by a guy called True, but I think True would be very happy to spawn something similar in London quite a bit later.
So let's move on to your own talk later. How can we actually use design to make city living a happier experience?
Well, I think in 5 million ways, and I think that there literally everybody can contribute because, very obviously, if you live in a place like Amsterdam, your shoes, your iPad, your chair, this floor, this building, this street, this district, and the entire city, including all of the parks and including all of nature, has been designed by somebody. And so there is zero nature around in Amsterdam. It's all been designed. And so you can very, very easily argue that all this design has about the same impact on us as nature would have on somebody who lives in the forest in Papua Guinea. Like, it's all encompassing. And having lived, I was for 2 months in Rome last summer. And let's say, if you compare how those 2 months went to if I would have moved to 2 months to, let's say, Des Moines, Iowa, not one of my favorite places on earth. There is a significant difference there. It's a significant difference how I feel, how I'm touched by my environment. And I mean, in Rome, you know, clearly, I would say out of the 2,000 years that it's old, probably 600 or 700 years of it, it was the leading city of the world, attracting the best of the best who would work there. And you see it, and with Italian culture being, for many of those hundreds of years that they were in charge, completely geared towards beauty, it has an effect on you. And I mean, while there's also very clear, I mean, you just have to, if we go back to the mass tourism issue, there is a reason why you have this problem, and Des Moines, Iowa has none of that problem, zero. There is no tourism in Des Moines, Iowa.
Hopefully we have no one from Iowa here.
Yeah.
Okay, let's move to two questions now from the audience. Anyone with a question?
I do have a question. Mm-hmm. Hi. I'm Lisette Thijsman.
What's your name, please?
Lisette Thijsman from
Lisette,
Amsterdam.
Thank you.
And I'm a teacher at art schools, and I help students in their final thesis. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I encounter is that people do not read a lot of newspapers mm-hmm. anymore, young people. And I was wondering if you, as a designer, have any ideas that you can make like serious newspapers like in Holland, like NRC or Volkskrant or New York Times, what you can do as a designer to make them more attractive to people. Because what I notice is that people read nu.nl, which is very short lines about news, but mm-hmm. not like in-depth stories. And I always hope people do that mm-hmm. because that makes their thesis more better, you know, more mm-hmm. grounded mm-hmm. and better arguments and stuff. Mm-hmm. But I was wondering, as a designer, did you find any ideas how to make that more attractive to people to mm-hmm. read longer stories?
Well, I mean, I myself am of that generation who loves longer stories. You know, I read the long articles in the New York Times, and I do read the New Yorker. Like, I'm more attracted to that, and even those are often too short for me, and I much prefer long things to short things in general. Like, you know, I'd much rather read a novel than a collection of short stories. I think that I find a similar situation towards a direction for longness among, let's say, the designers who work for us. And because my partner Jessica, my business partner Jessica, is only 28, we have a very, very young group of designers also working with us. And I, let's say, if I look at short versus long, in film, the tendency seems to be it goes towards long. Like, I'm not sure if you have that in Europe, but in the States there's an incredible rise of the quality TV series that people watch in binges over a weekend the whole season. And where serious people and serious, like that, where you see people who were involved in movies only switch towards TV because they get more freedom and they can do better work. And I would say, if I look at The Sopranos, it would be difficult for me to find many films of that kind of quality. So it seems that in the moving picture sense, there is a tendency towards the longer form. My guess would be that because it's not only the newspapers that are going down, it's also the TV news that are going down. My guess would be that, at least from what I can observe among the designers who work with us, is that that generation is less politically interested, and not always in a bad way. Like, I've heard, and I actually heard that from a young Dutch designer who said that the days for being against things are over. And I think that it was meant as a critique of my generation, of this love of critical thinking, which sometimes, and I was surprised, like Cameron put that on the thing very much, like first question everything. Mm-hmm. That's one of the areas where I totally disagree with Cameron. I think that the question on everything, that fear of being naive, is completely overvalued. I think that naivete would be an incredibly healthy way to be. That my generation is far too cynical, far too questioning. And specifically, like when I was in art school, like critical thinking was sort of like seen as the highest form of thinking. That's what we aspire to, the best. I found that critical thinking is the stupidest kind of thinking. Like basically, to sit somewhere and say this politician is an idiot and this piece of design is shit, that's the easiest. And I can see it in meetings. Like the people who always sort of like see the problem, they're always the idiots. They're always the most stupidest people in the meeting. The people who actually can say yes and couldn't we do this, that's a much more sophisticated way of moving forward. Like to can actually make a suggestion. And I think that there, my feeling is that among young designers, there is a discontent with my generation, with their emphasis on being involved politically, and a fairly deliberate coupling out of there and seeing a circumvention of these sort of like involvement politically and an involvement that probably goes more indirectly, less through direct politics and more through other human interaction, which might be through social media, which might be through meetups. And I don't see neither my students nor the people who work with us that they are any less engaged than we were. Actually, almost the opposite. I actually find that, I mean, I've recently had the pleasure of spending 2 days with a guy called Perry Chan, who is one of the founders of Kickstarter, who I think is 29. And my God, I've never met anybody that intelligent and that smart and that wise. Definitely, when I was 29, I was not like that. I remember that much. And I didn't know anybody who was like that, who, you know, created a serious, impactful business, refuses to sell it even though he could make millions and millions of dollars, becomes an artist instead, and lets the business grow and move it at the same time. I mean, just incredible wisdom on the shoulders of somebody who has been only on this earth for 29 years. Amazing to me, and I find a good amount of. I had breakfast today with a young designer from Holland, unbelievably smart. And it's a pity that she's not here. It would be interesting to hear her talk if she actually reads the newspapers. I don't know, but it could easily. I wouldn't be surprised if she doesn't, but I would also say it doesn't matter.
We're just a little short on time. Sorry to interrupt you, but let's move on. And I'm just mindful of the time we have. I just want to talk about some urban issue solutions here. So we kind of started to look at some solutions, and when we started talking about the problem of urban issues, we kind of thought that, you know, that they were all big kind of issues, and you know, the solutions all had to kind of be about architecture or engineering or something. But then, as we kind of dug down into it, we started to find some kind of interesting solutions. So, for instance, one issue we spoke about earlier is about the kind of the rent increases in cities, and empty retail units leave kind of a grey city centre. So we found a great piece of work by Ben Ein in London, who kind of started painting the empty shutters in Shoreditch with these alphabets. And so he kind of brings a brightness to the city center there. Also, we have our own example in Amsterdam Laser 3.14, who uses temporary structures. He doesn't write on walls. He writes on kind of placards and things which will be taken away ultimately. And he writes these kind of
kind of poetic pieces, mm-hmm. which he just leaves behind, and they just appear all over the city. And he's very prolific. And, you know, there's a message there mm-hmm. in every one. It mm-hmm. makes you think. This is a common hazard in Amsterdam, crossing the street. If you're a tourist, being hit by a tram or a bike is something that might happen. So we started to think about solutions here. I'm not going to kind of go into this because there's films here, but there was a campaign by Smart in Lisbon where they created a dancing traffic light. So that was a kind of a way to get people's attention to make them stop. I'll move on from this one though. We mentioned Airbnb and the backlash about Airbnb, you know, the fact it's become so prolific. Also Uber, trying to get a taxi in the city has been a problem mm-hmm. for a number of years, and I think Uber has helped to kind of shake up that industry. That's had a pushback, I think, as well. Uber Pop, I think that was banned, so you have to be registered to actually be a taxi mm-hmm. driver here with Uber, so Uber Black, I think, still works. Mm-hmm. And of course, the loss of green spaces. We have an office in Mexico City, and one of our designers posted this to us, which is called a pocket park. So quite in the built-up areas, Mexico City Council, I think, they kind of create these temporary spaces to actually give some kind of play spaces in built-up areas, and they just pop up all over the place. Also, University of Greenwich in London has a plan in mind to kind of create green spaces on the tops of the buildings there, because of course the surrounding area is being really, really built up with very, very high rise buildings, so this creates a new landscape in London. And one which I guess we're all familiar with is living in your phone, and that can of course cause a hazard in the city centre. So we found this really nice solution, which was in Washington DC. They have a dedicated smartphone lane, so that you don't end up walking into someone. So it's a kind of a safety, and also it's fun. So and you also spoke yesterday about two of your great pieces of work, which I'd love to hear more about.
Well, this is actually our only Amsterdam project. This was initiated by the city. The budget was 6,500 euros. So we got 650,000 euro coins from the Dutch Central Bank. And they nicely could give us three different types. So they gave us brand new ones, medium used ones, and fairly old ones. So we had three different color variations. And it was clear on what space we would get this. So this is new apartment buildings on the left, on the top, and on the bottom, on the right, seven stories high. And we used the grid of the stones that was existing there with 100 volunteers to carefully lay out the different coins. I mean, I think you can read it. It says, obsessions make my life worse and my work better. It took us a week with the 100 volunteers to put it up. And the idea was we had sprayed them all in a very particular electric blue on the other side so that we could track them as they would disperse all over Europe. Obviously, the coins you can use in every country, we could track them down, and we had a website built up that was allowing the tracking. And of course, with the reason we made it pretty was that a viewer would have to make a decision. Do they want to keep the piece intact, or do they want to take as much money as they can? It was on purpose unguarded. And so what happened, as soon as it was done, a guy came with two plastic bags to take away as many coins he could do. And then one of the neighbors who had seen us building it up got very upset about it, that this guy would just take the money. And she called the police. And that Amsterdam police, in all their wisdom, like, came, saw this piece, said, well, this clearly is a piece of art and it needs saving. So they swept it all up and took the coins under protection into police headquarters. So the whole piece literally lasted for like 4 or 5 hours. And there was no tracking on any website necessary afterwards.
Yeah. You also told a great story yesterday about this piece of work in particular, about the transformation.
Yeah. Can you go back on Well, it's another very good possibility to see. But basically, it's an underpass of the BQE, the Brooklyn Queens Expressway in Dumbo in Brooklyn, in a now fairly dense, fairly good area, formerly very bad area. The improvement district there knew that the underpass was always a blight. People peed in there, and they asked us to do something very cheap. In this case, it was a $5,000 budget. So it was clear we couldn't do all that much with the $5,000, but we said, let's just paint it. And because there's car traffic, there is bike traffic, and there is foot traffic. So on one side, we painted, yes, in a very elaborate kind of, not sea monster, but kind of like, you know, squid kind of way. And on the other side, we printed yes, just in black and white, so that the cars would see a yes, but the bikes would see a yes, and then the foot traffic would see a more elaborate yes. That was basically, the idea is not bigger than that, and the yes, I would say the grandmother of this project would definitely be Yoko Ono. I'm not sure if you know that, her yes story. Does everybody know that? Otherwise I'll tell it. Like, when there's a story, I'm not 100% sure if it's true, but that's definitely the story, is when the way John Lennon met Yoko Ono was that he went into a gallery, and in the gallery there was a ladder, and he went up that ladder, and on the ceiling was a little box, and he opened the box, and inside the box it said yes. And that prompted that, so made him feel so great that he asked the gallerist, who is that artist who did that? And then she introduced him to Yoko. And John said in an interview that if he would have said no, he would have never wanted to meet the artist. So it's just a message, just basically a positive message. But what happened is that I've now received many, many, many photos of people who are getting married in the underpass of the BQE, because it says yes big on the side. So literally the $5,000 worth of paint transformed this from a pissoir into a wedding site.
Great.
Which we were, of course, obviously very happy about.
Yeah. So let's get a question from the audience.
Oh, and even better for us, it turned out that the people who gave the development guys the money, the $5,000 for us to do this, was a big Brooklyn developer who is very, very smart, and they recently contacted us for a giant job that pays much more than $5,000 because they and it has nothing to do with this. It's basically a much more straightforward real estate promotional project, but they were ultimately swayed by how successful the transformation was of this thing. So it actually, which I think is ultimately what's happening most of the time, if you do something that's actually successful for the community, it's always the success always comes back to you. It somehow, it just, that seems to be how things work, like that ultimately it's our own advantage again. Mm-hmm. Even though clearly on this project, we, you know, if I count the hours, we lost quite a bit of money on it, and we just thought, oh, that doesn't matter, but, you know, it's worthwhile to do. But ultimately, it all falls back on us again. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Hi.
Hi. What's your name, please?
Ovette, and it's a pleasure to be here. You said before that functionalism doesn't work, mm-hmm. or didn't work. But you've sort of implied that beauty does work. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering whether you have any theory as to what makes something beautiful.
But I think that there is a surprising consensus in what is beautiful. And I myself am mostly interested in man-made beauty. There is a whole other world out there, obviously, of natural beauty. And I find man-made just more interesting because we can actually do something about it. And I'm normally more impressed by it. And I'll give you an example. Let's say if I look, I happen to have a nice view from my roof in New York City. And if I look out from my roof over the Manhattan skyline, I get a feeling, that same feeling of awe and wonder, not all the times, but here and there, that I get when I look out over the Alps. And that is amazing, considering we made it. And we made it in 300 years. You know, the Alps is like, you know, they took them 300 million years to make it, you know. So I'm concentrating on man-made beauty. And it seems that there is a surprising, that we actually think very similar about it. And the reason I know that is because of research. There is very little good research out there. It's not only in design and in art that beauty kind of has fallen off the table as a piece of interest and discussion. It apparently, the same thing is true in science. That there is actually an institute in psychology, there's an institute for aesthetics in psychology that actually is headed by an Austrian guy, and I talked to him, Helmut Leder, who says there's very little good research. But one of the guys that I talked to is who I actually met in Holland, a scientist from the UK, who took one of the preeminent Dutch artists, Mondrian, and basically played with it. And I was at the conference, but he was nice enough to give me his slides, and I've used them in talks, and I will use them in talks in the future. But he basically took three of the more unknown Mondrians, but the classic ones with the black stripes and the red and yellow fields and blue fields, and faked it. Just moved the lines a little bit, made the spaces a little bit bigger and a little bit smaller, and he always shows both to an audience, and says which is the Mondrian, which is the real, which is the fake. 80 to 90% of audiences realize which is the real Mondrian, even though very much likely none of them has seen the real Mondrian before, because they're not the one who hang at the stage link. And I, of course, immediately thought, well, it must be the golden means. You know, probably Mondrian worked with the golden means. We are so accustomed to the golden means that we find this more beautiful than the other. But Mondrian did not work with the golden means. So it really is, and we do know that he worked extremely hard on getting them right, because we can now make X-rays, and you see that he moved the lines around quite a lot before he settled on his final compositions. And apparently, we agree. And this is non-art. Like, I've done it in front of teachers. I've done it recently in front of a bunch of real estate sellers in Austria. 90% get it. So it seems that there is agreement on what is beautiful, even in abstract art. And, you know, if you look at surveys, let's say, which is the most beautiful city? 100% agreement on Paris. No, not true. Not 100%, but it's a very clear. There's a very clear number one, and it's Paris, which, by the way, is the same city that Corbusier wanted to completely bulldoze and replace it with his own things. And for example, in our own work, and the reason that I got interested in beauty, because I used to be utterly uninterested in beauty, I didn't hate it, it just was not of my concern, was really only experience. That I found that when we accidentally made something look good, it seemed to work much better. This is now in communications, as far as design, like graphics is concerned. It just always worked much better, to the point where we now really, really take it seriously, and our stuff works much better since we do it. And we find it unbelievably difficult to find young designers that can make things look good because art schools don't teach it. It's all about concepts and good ideas and almost nothing about the formal qualities. And it's very interesting to me is that Dutch design always used to be heavily formal, specifically Dutch graphic design. I mean, that's basically was its strength, like, you know, the strength of the form, and the UK was always heavily based, idea-based, conception-based, and Dutch, specifically that generation, like Karl Martens and so on, was very heavy in form-giving. And I went to the Stedelijk yesterday, and it's all this bullshit quotes on the wall. Completely without form. So it's interesting to me that just when I get really interested in form, Dutch design seems to be moving away from that. Who knows? But maybe I'm completely wrong and the Stedelijk was just an exception.
Yeah. We actually have got a question here from someone at an art school, Wesley from St. Joost in Breda. We actually visited them in our quest for finding solutions to urban issues, and yep. Wesley had a nice question. We have to be mindful of the time. We're very short on time, so please keep the question short. The question short, of course, but maybe the answer equally short.
Ik vroeg me af hoe ik ontwerpers duidelijk kon maken om een maatschappelijke positie in te nemen.
So if young designers should take a stand in society?
Yeah, so how can I make it clear that young designers should take a stand in society? And Wesley's up here. If you'd like to stand up, Wesley.
Yeah. Hi. Okay. Okay, but... I mean, I think that... And I think I've said that before, that I don't think that there is a specific responsibility for designers to be involved in social issues that exceeds that of other professions. What I do think is that what it means to be human and what it means to live a full life is also to be involved in something that's bigger than you. So I think from a particular, from a very selfish point of view, if I myself look at my life, I should be involved in my friends and family and have good connections there. I should be involved in my job and with myself and find a good relationship there. But then I should also be involved in something that's larger than me. And I think for many people, that could be religion. And I think many people, and why most surveys show that religious people tend to be happier than non-religious people, stems from that because they feel that they are involved in something that's just bigger than themselves. And for non-religious people, I think that often is some sort of bigger social issue, be it sustainability or be it whatever. And it can be social issues that I agree with, and social issues that I completely non-agree with.
I'm being handed this card.
Not in 5 minutes,
we,
but
we
now.
We must end now. It's been crossed
yes.
out.
Yeah.
In 5 minutes. Okay.
I think we are.
Let's just
over.
Wrap up.
Yeah.
So let's kind of look to the future here. I think we've seen some interesting solutions to urban issues. And I think one of our key findings when we were looking at this subject was that the solutions don't actually have to be about engineering or architecture. They can simply be something that stimulates you. Mm-hmm. And so the bubble project is a good example of how we can where we can do this. And also, why not turn a negative into a positive? So see a problem as an opportunity. So you know, it's not all about doom and gloom. Finding these solutions can actually be really rewarding in themselves as well. And finally, why don't we do something with this? Why don't we actually kind of look for some opportunities to these problems and actually do something with it? And we'd love to hear from you in terms of creating solutions for urban issues. Any of the things that have inspired you today, please contact us. If you have a solution, we'd love to talk to you further about it. And finally, I'd like to thank you very much for coming in and sharing your time with us and for your wisdom as well.
Thank you so much. Thank you for the presentation. Thanks a lot. Thank you. And thank you.
Parking your car. So Amsterdam's a city of bikes. We have you a really amazing gift for your bike here. So please put it on your bike and remember us.
Excellent. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
A closing word. Those of you who signed up for the portfolio review and the box of goodies is there. So please come to Connie and pick it up. Yeah. Another thing is that Babette has launched her project about hidden sources of energy and all that, which today starts a crowdfunding campaign. So she's here, and please visit her, because that way you can belong to something bigger than yourself. Okay. Thank you so much.